Okay, we'll continue with other aspects of our finite element method. We're sticking still with our linear one-dimensional elliptic PDE, but what I want to do now is take the opportunity to go to the case where we could have a problem, a boundary value problem, where all the boundary data are specified as Dirichlet data. Okay, so what if there is no Neumann data? Okay, so we will call the segment pure Dirichlet problems. Okay, or just Dirichlet problems. So, in the context of what we are doing here, the statement is the following. Find UH belonging to SH, which is a subset of S, okay, where S consists of all functions U such that U at 0 equals U naught, and U at L equals U given. Okay? Now, since SH is a subset of S, what this implies, of course, for us, for our finite dimensional weak form, is that SH consists of functions UH. Now, they could belong to H1, right? Like we have considered for our finite dimensional weak form when we consider Dirichlet and Neumann data. Okay, so UH belongs to H1 on omega such that UH at 0 equals U0 and UH at L equals UG. Right? This is the kind of UH we want to find. Okay, so find UH of this form such that for all WH belonging to VH, and just for consistency with what I wrote above, let me do this properly. VH is a subset of V, which consists of all functions W, such that W at 0 equals 0, and now W at L also equals 0. Okay? So wherever we have Dirichlet data, the weighting function satisfies the homogeneous Dirichlet condition. Okay? And then this implies for us that VH consists of all functions WH also belonging to the space H1 on omega such that WH of 0 equals 0 and WH at L also equals 0. Okay? Okay, so essentially we're saying find UH belonging to SH where SH consists of functions that have that are H1 and have Dirichlet data on both ends. Okay? Such that for all WH belonging to VH, which now consists of functions satisfying homogeneous Dirichlet data, right, at x equals 0 and x equals L. Okay? Okay. What needs to hold? Well, the same old weak form. Integral over omega WH, comma x, sigma H, A, dx equals integral over omega WH F A dx. And we're done. there is no Neumann data, right? There are no Neumann boundary conditions in this problem. So we don't have the contribution from the traction, right? This is it. Okay. Essentially, the formulation is the same as we've studied for the Dirichlet-Neumann problem. The only detail is what happens with our homogeneous Dirichlet conditions on the weighting function. Okay, so here's a picture actually. So the physical picture, if you care for it, is this one. Right, at this end we know that we have U naught, which we know we're thinking of as being equal to zero. At this end, we have not a traction condition, but we have that the displacement, if this is an elasticity problem, is equal to some given value, right? Alternately, if this were a heat conduction or a mass diffusion problem, it would say that we would be saying that we have the temperature specified at both ends, right? Or maybe the concentration specified at both ends, right? And we have, of course, our forcing. Right, this is F. Okay. Don't know if I need, sorry. Right, this is our forcing in this direction. Okay. Right, so this is the physical picture. Now we proceed just as before, right? Let's assume that we have a decomposition of the domain, a partition of the domain into our elements, right? Into subdomains, which are elements. That would be omega 1. That would be omega NEL. Okay? Now, observe that what we're saying is that because of the form of our Dirichlet data at both boundary nodes, we are going to do something special about the weighting function, the basis functions for the weighting function in elements omega 1 and omega NEL. Okay? So what this implies is that as far as basis functions go, okay, again, let's suppose that we are working with linear polynomials over, you know, these are polynomials with compact support, right? Just as before, all of that is the same, right, over each element omega e. Okay, so then what we're saying is that WH in element e equals 1 is equal to only basis function 2, okay, and our basis functions 1 and basis function 2 are exactly the same as before, okay. So we take only basis function 2, function of xi through x, times C 2 E equals 1. Okay? And the same sort, well, the similar sort of thing holds for element E equals N E L. Okay? This one is which one? Which basis function do we use for element N E L? Remember that this element is this one. Element 1 is this, right? And so what we're saying is that for omega h, we use only that basis function, right, in element 2, sorry, in element 1. Element NEL, on the other hand, is going to be this one, right? I jumped ahead of myself by also drawing the basis function, right? But you get the idea. That is the basis function, the only one that we will use in element NEL. Okay? So this one is just N1 C1 E equals NEL. Okay? So really, this is the only thing. This is really the only difference. Now, when we go back and look at our the integrals contributing to our weak forms, okay? So we'll get the following, okay? Integral over omega w h comma x sigma h a dx equals. Now, when we work things through, what we will see is that we get in element 1, we get C 2 1, okay, multiplying E A over H E minus 1 1. And here the column vector is D1 for element 1, D2 for element 1. Okay? We get the usual summation over all the over the remaining elements, E equals 2 to NEL minus 1. Okay? I'm sorry, I should. Too close to that one. Okay, right? Note that this sum goes from element 2 to element NEL minus 1. Okay, so that means that we are looking at all the elements in between here, right, as contributing the same sort of term, okay, as I'm about to write out in this summation. Okay, so here we get properly C1 element E, C2 element E, E A over H E. Our little matrix here, which gives us our element stiffness matrix, will be 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1. And multiplying it here are the degrees of freedom, D1E, D2E. And then added on to this is the very last, the contribution from the very last element, from element NEL, which we have above us here in the figure, right? In the figure. And here we see that the contribution comes only from that degree of freedom, okay? And in our global numbering system, right? Or, well, let's look at it in our local numbering system. That is C1NEL, right? Element NEL, okay? Just as this, as far as C degrees of freedom are concerned, was C2 element 1. So here we get C1. NEL multiplying EA over HE. Okay? EA over HE, but now this contribution from the so-called stiffness contribution from this element, it takes on the form 1 minus 1, and here we get it is multiplied by D1 for element NEL and D2 for element NEL. Okay? And in a related manner, In a related manner, what we will see is that what we obtain is that as far as our force contributions are concerned, right, which come only from our forcing function, there being no traction condition here, WHFADX equals. Okay, so just as before, we will get a contribution C21FAHE/2. Okay, this would be the only contribution, right, from element 1. From the other elements, right, we will get a contribution which has the same form as our main sum over all the elements when we were doing the Dirichlet-Neumann problem, right? This is a sum going from E equals 2 to NEL minus 1, and here in this sum, the contributions from the degrees of freedom for weighting functions are C1E, C2E, F, A, HE over 2. Okay. This thing now would be multiplied by 1 and 1. And finally, from the very last element, we would get once again C1NEL. We would have FAHE/2. Okay? These are the contributions we would get. Right? And really, this is, you know, if you go back and look at our general Dirichlet-Neumann problem, what you will see is that we are just accounting for, if you look at this term, right, if you look at how we obtained this term, right, you could go back to the Dirichlet-Neumann problem, right, and look at what we had for the very last element, and in there simply set C2NEL, right, equal to 0, which would be like setting the weighting function corresponding to the second node of that element equal to 0. Okay, and this is what you would be left with. And the same would apply for this term here. Okay, if you were to do the same thing in the force contribution. Right, so this is all you would be left with.